Good afternoon, children.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
We were discussing about pteridophytes in the previous class, and I want to hear those points which we discussed already about pteridophytes. Who will start? Emeline, what all points we learned?
They have true stem, leaves, and roots, and they have a well-defined vascular tissue.
Only one point. Okay, then. Children, do turn your videos on. I have problem only with audio. I can see your videos clearly. If not turned on also, I can make out. Okay. Devi Krishna, next point.
Pteridophyte, the dominant species is saprophyte. Four of
them. Treya, really I cannot make out what you are saying, but still, yes. Sreya, where are you? Next point. Okay, Anjana, it's okay. Sreya, video is paused. Malavika Vibin, profile photo is looking super, but I want to see your face. Malavika, are you there? Aneshwara?
Ma'am, evolutionary, they are the first terrestrial plants to have vascular tissue.
Atulya? Why are you turning the pages when I asked you a question?
Dominant phase is sporophyte.
Sporophyte? You said about sporophyte, no?
Yes, dominant.
What did you say?
Phase, dominant phase.
Okay, dominant phase is sporophyte. Then Anila? Any other point that we learned? Anila, unmute and speak. Sanjana, Agnes, Reya, you all turn your videos on. Okay, Anila. Shabari? Without? Because if you don't turn your video on, I won't be able to make out anything. Okay. Where we stopped last class? Shabari, unmute. Okay. We'll continue, children. So we'll be learning about methods of reproduction. Already we learned a few points. Quickly we will see from reproduction again. Sporophytes. Sporophyte is the main plant body, and they have got sporangia on the lower surface of leaf-like appendages, which you call as sporophylls. And in certain cases, these sporophylls, instead of forming leaf-like structures, they form cones or strobili. And that you can find in Selaginella and Equisetum. Then we learned about the prothallus, the gametophyte present in them, and sporangia, within the sporangia, you know, sporangia are present on sporophylls. On the lower surface of sporophyll, sporangia are present, and within the sporangia, spore mother cells are present. And these spore mother cells will undergo reduction division or meiotic division, and they will form spores. And once these spores germinate, they will produce prothallus, thalloid gametophyte, which you call as prothallus. The features of prothallus include: they are small, inconspicuous, not very prominent or distinct. They are multicellular. They have an independent existence, so they are free living, and they are photosynthetic. So sporophyte is the dominant plant body. Sporophyte consists of sporophylls, and on the lower surface of the sporophylls, sporangia are present, and within the sporangia, spore mother cells are found, and they undergo reduction, division, and form spores. And this also we had discussed in the last class. Prothallus requires cool, damp and shady places. They can grow well in moist and damp places. And it requires water for carrying out fertilization. And hence we say that the distribution of pteridophytes is limited, or they are found in only certain regions. Because if water is absent, then in such places they will not be able to survive. Because to carry out reproduction, they need fertilization, even though they are terrestrial plants. And you have also learned that these are the first terrestrial plants with well-developed vascular system. And the prothallus consists of both male and female sex organs, and they are named as antheridia and archegonia. Water is needed for fertilization. I told you that point. That is why its distribution is limited, and you are finding it only in certain regions, certain geographic locations only you can find it. If water is scarce in such places, you cannot find these plants. And water is needed. Why water is needed for fertilization? Just like we discussed in the case of bryophytes, for transferring the male gametes from the antheridia, from the male sex organ, the male gametes or antherozoids produced should be transferred to the mouth of archegonium. And inside archegonium, egg cell is present. So it has to reach the egg cell. First, it will reach the mouth of the archegonia. From there, it will find its way to fuse with the egg cell within. And for this purpose, water is needed. And once it fuses, just like in any other case, once the male gamete fuses with the female gamete, here the female gamete is egg cell and the male gamete is antherozoid. Once fusion is successful, it will result in the formation of a zygote. And zygote develops into a multicellular, well-differentiated sporophyte. Okay? The gametophyte or prothallus consists of male and female sex organs. These male and female sex organs will produce male and female gametes respectively. They fuse, they form a zygote. Zygote will develop into multicellular, well-differentiated sporophyte. Again, the cycle gets repeated. Sporophyte with sporophylls produce spores within the sporangia. Spores will germinate and they will form gametophyte. Again, this gametophyte will bear sex organs. Gametes will be produced. They will fuse. Zygote will be formed. And once zygote is formed, they will develop into sporophyte. And this gets repeated. Here you can see pictures of a few pteridophytes, Elaginella, Salvinia, etc. And most of the pteridophytes, they produce similar kinds of spores. So spores, sometimes it can be different types of spores. Sometimes they will produce similar types of spores. If they are producing dissimilar spores, spores of different kinds, then you call them as heterosporous. And if they are producing spores of similar kind, you call it as homosporous. Homo, same. Hetero, different. Heterosporous, different spores. Homosporous, producing similar spores. Most of them, they produce similar kinds of spores. You call it as homosporous. Others produce two kinds of spores. Selaginella, Salvinia, they can produce two types of spores. Some are small in size, some are big in size. Macro or mega, megaspores or macrospores, both indicate large sized spores, whereas microspore, you can see the picture there. If you compare the size, you can find one is small, one is large. So macro or megaspores will be large in size, whereas microspores will be small in size. Since they are producing two types or two kinds of spores, you call it as heterosporous. Homosporous means all the spores produced will be of similar size. And majority of the pteridophytes are homosporous. They produce similar kinds of spores. the megaspores and microspores. And what happens to these spores? You know that once the spores are produced, spores will germinate and form prothallus or the gametophyte. So here also, megaspores and microspores. So if two types of spores are there, megaspores will develop into female gametophyte and microspores will develop into male gametophyte. So two types, in majority of them, only one kind of spores will be produced. And in such case, on the same prothallus, you can see both male and female male and female sex organs. And in some cases, they produce two types of spores. And in such case, these spores will develop into male and female gametophytes respectively. This big size spores will germinate and form female gametophyte, and small size spores will form male gametophyte. Always remember that, just as in the case of human beings, the gametes, male gamete will be small in size, female gamete is big in size. So accordingly, the smaller spores will form male gametophyte and larger spores will form female gametophyte. And the female gametophytes, it will be retained within the parent sporophyte for variable periods, depending upon the species. The time you cannot generalize. So depending upon the species, the female, not the male, the female gametophytes will be retained within the parent sporophyte. It is the parent sporophyte because it's from here the spores are produced, which have resulted in the formation of these gametophytes. So the female gametophyte can be retained, can remain attached to the parent sporophyte. And the time period, it is different. For a variable, you cannot say a fixed time, it can vary. So for variable periods, that might remain attached to the sporophyte from where they were formed. Within the female gametophyte, zygotes develop into young embryos. You know that it is within the female gametophyte that the zygote is being formed. Why? Because female gametophyte will bear female sex organs, and it is within the female sex organ that egg is present. Egg cannot move. The male gametes will reach the female sex organ and fuse with the egg cell there. So that is why it is said the zygote, the fusion of fertilization, will be taking place within the female sex organ present in the female gametophyte, and therefore zygote will be remaining within the female gametophyte. I think you have no confusion why zygote is present within the female gametophyte. Female gametophyte bears female sex organ, archegonium. It is within the archegonium that egg is present, egg cell is present. Egg cell will not move and reach the antherozoid. Instead, antherozoids, with the help of water, they will reach the mouth of the archegonium, enters it, fuses with the egg cell. And once the fusion is completed, it will form zygote. So zygote will be present within the female gametophyte, and this is considered as a precursor to the seed habit. You know, they don't produce seeds. Instead, they are spore-bearing plants. Pteridophyte is spore-bearing. They don't produce seeds. Seeds are produced by other higher plants, and they don't produce seeds, but the method of formation of the zygote is similar to that of the seed formation. So we call it as a forerunner or precursor of seed habit. By evolution, this might have changed into seed formation in higher plants. So somewhat similar to seed formation, this process takes place. And hence, this process, that is the process of formation of zygote within the female gametophyte, is considered to be a precursor of seed habit. And you know that in higher plants, in angiosperms and all, seed formation is also taking place in the same way. Once fertilization is completed, ovule with the embryo inside will change into seed, and the ovary will change into fruit. So here seed formation is not taking place because they are lower plants, and in them, or they are spore bearing plants, but we have seed bearing plants also. And this feature, this process of formation of zygote within the female gametophyte is considered to be a precursor, a forerunner to the seed habit. It is considered as an important step in evolution. So as a result of evolution in the higher plants, this might have changed into seed formation. Okay. Any doubts? But if you ask doubts also, you will have to use the chat box. Can I proceed? At least your hand, thumbs up or something, if you can show. You want me to repeat it again? I can. You want me to repeat the points again? No need. This itself is more than enough, no, Malavika. Tired of hearing. I don't know whether my voice is disturbing or not, but I don't know. I know that when we are using this headset and in online classes, I don't have to shout like this, but can't change, you know. For long years, this was the habit because we used to address the whole classroom and we used to shout at the top of the voice. And even in the online classes, repeating the same thing. I don't know if my voice is disturbing. Please let me know. I know if I speak in a feeble voice also, it will reach, but can't change. I try myself, but I'm not getting satisfied because we are not trained to do so. No, not disturbing. No, voice is not piercing into the ears, but still some are yawning and sleeping. Yes, no, Elaine? Have you understood? You want any points to be repeated? Agna, Anjana, Irene, Sreya, Nehal, Devika. Are you there, children? Irene, Sreya, Nehal, Devika, Hasif, Agna, Sanjana, Abhinav, Malavika, Vibin. So many messages. Okay, I'll repeat. Which one, Adulya? Which point? The whole thing, what we covered, you want me to repeat? Yes?
Yes.
I'll repeat it once again. Maybe others also have the same opinion. They are not saying. They are not messaging. See, others, please turn your videos on. Alin, Anjana, Anishwara, Abhinav, Hasif, Alina, Agna. I think one or two messaged me that they have some connectivity issues. That's okay. Other than that, you just turn it on. Okay, Alan Joshi, Anjana. Okay, others can turn it on. I'll repeat the points again. If you have any confusion, if you need any clarity, just leave me a message. I'll check the messages. We started with this one, no? This slide. I think that was in, yes. We started with, so this we had completed in the previous period. So I'll begin from here. Once again, I'm going to repeat the points. Those who haven't understood, please check it once again. Water is needed for carrying out the fusion of male and female gametes. The reason is antherozoids or the male gametes produced within the antheridium. If they have to reach archegonium so as to fuse with the egg cell present inside, they need water. They are terrestrial plants. But for the transport of these male gametes, they need the presence of water. Once antherozoid or the male gamete fuses with the egg cell, which is present within the archegonium, it will result in the formation of a zygote. All these terms, I know, it is new. These are new for you. So you have to take a conscious effort to be thorough with all these terms. Antheridium, archegonium, sporophyll, sporophyte, gametophyte. So make it thorough. And I think only in this chapter you will find it difficult to learn all these terms. In the next chapter, it is more or less continuation of what you had learned in class 9, Animal Kingdom. Comparatively easy. But here so many terms are there. So try to learn it writing or reading, or somehow you make some code so that you don't get confused. Some flow charts, as I always used to say, make some flow charts or concept maps so that you will not forget. It is not I had forwarded one or two concept maps. So when someone else is preparing, you may not be able to follow. When you prepare on your own, that will be very easy. Whatever is convenient or whichever way it is convenient, you can prepare so that you will not forget all these. Otherwise, all these, you will get confused. You don't have to prepare a concept map for the entire chapter. Instead, you can take separate division. Algae, you can prepare one flowchart. Bryophytes, you can prepare another one. Pteridophytes, another one. I think that will be easy than putting together everything in a same concept map. Okay. Anthrozoid, once it fuses with the egg cell, it will form a zygote. And zygote will develop into a sporophyte. Zygote is formed by the fusion of male and female gametes. Where are these male and female gametes formed? Within male and female sex organs. And where are these male and female sex organs present? In the gametophyte. So from the gametophyte, gametes are produced and these gametes fuse, form a zygote, which will develop into the next phase of its life cycle, that is sporophyte. And now sporophyte will give rise to gametophyte. Again, gametophyte will produce sporophyte. Now, sporophyte has been formed by the development of zygote. Now, coming to the types of spores. Sometimes, or majority of the pteridophytes, they produce similar size or similar kinds of spores. In such a condition, you can call them as homosporous. Homo, similar, same, homosporous, same type of spores. Whereas heterosporous means they produce two different kinds of spores. Some will be larger in size and some will be smaller in size. Hetero means different. Macrospores and microspores. Macrospores, even you can call it as megaspores. And microspores, small sized spores. And macrospores will develop into female gametophyte and microspores will develop into male gametophyte. Example, Selaginella and Salvinia. Children, in spite of repeatedly saying, majority of you are not turning the videos on, I will not mark attendance. Children, afterwards, don't feel bad when I mark absent for you. Genuine cases, I understand, but half of the class turning the video on, that cannot be accepted. If you're not interested, you're free to skip the class. But once you've joined, you will have to follow the rules. Irene, who is troubling you there? Your sister?
Okay.
You have, it's optional. Either you join or you don't join. But once you join, I want to see your face. Unless you have some connectivity issues. So this point already I told you, megaspores, microspores. Megaspores will germinate and form female gametophyte. Microspores will germinate and form male gametophyte. And in certain Prothallus, you saw both like male and female sex organs are present in the same gametophyte. And when two types of spores are produced, male and female gametophytes will be produced. And the female gametophyte for variable periods, so depending upon the species, for different periods, they'll remain attached to the sporophyte. And within the female gametophyte, the fusion of male and female gametes will take place. And this is considered to be a precursor of seed habit. And it has got a lot of significance, or it is a significant character with respect to evolution. It is by means of evolution. These, as I said, gymnosperms are spore bearing, but higher plants are seed bearing. So this is considered as a forerunner of the seed habit. And over the years, as a result of evolution, it became, or this particular feature gradually evolved and led to the formation of seeds. But pteridophytes are spore bearing plants. Whereas gymnosperms and angiosperms are seed bearing. Classification of pteridophytes. How pteridophytes are classified? It is broadly classified into first one, Psilopsida, and you can see the pictures also. Example, Psilotum, then Lycopsida. Example, Selaginella, Lycopodium. And children, only the names and examples you need to learn. Explanation is not included in your syllabus. You don't have to learn the explanation, but you should know how are they classified, how are they subdivided, what are the different groups coming under that, and at least one example each. Psilopsida, Lycopsida, Phenopsida, and Pteropsida. So four groups are there: Psilopsida, Lycopsida, Phenopsida, Pteropsida. And Psilopsida, example, Psilotum, Lycopodium. I think that will be easy to remember than Selaginella because it is rhyming with the name of the group. Then Phenopsida, example, Equisetum. Pteropsida, example, Dryopteris. Then Edianthem and Pteris. These are the three examples. Dryopteris, Edianthem and Pteris are examples for Pteropsida. One example you can learn. Psilopsida, Lycopsida, Phenopsida and Pteropsida are the four groups coming under Pteridophyta. Okay. And examples for each: Psilotum, Lycopodium, Equisetum and Pteris or Dryopteris. Whichever is easy for you, you can learn that. Shall I stop sharing?
No.
Okay, we can have a recap of what we learned just now. Children, are you finding it very difficult to remember all these terms? I think this chapter you will find it more difficult. Now the chapters, rest of the chapters are not that tough like this. This is because you haven't learned much about plant kingdom. Animal kingdom, majority of the points and majority of the terms I think you're familiar with. Finding it difficult? Yes. So what is the solution? Namida, what is the solution? A repeated learning. Just by reading once or twice, you may not get. So repeated learning. You too have first term and second term exam. And the first term exam, I will post in the group. Only that term one, term two. Already it is there in the syllabus which I have forwarded. I think some of them join the group later. They might not have got it. So I will send it again. Just go through that. Okay. Who will start? Mary Angelina, what did we learn now? This period.
Ma'am, we learned about the classes of pteridophytes.
Lakshmi?
Ma'am? Water is needed for...
Tell me about homosporous and heterosporous. What is the difference? How are they different?
Most of the pteridophytes are similar kinds. They are known as homosporous.
Similar size spores and hetero?
They are different kinds. Megaspores and microspores.
Okay, so what will happen to these macrospores and microspores? In heterosporous plants, they'll be producing two types of spores, macro and microspores. Emeline, what will happen to macro and microspores?
Macroscope germinates and gives trace.
Don't read, Emeline.
Macroscopes are in female gametes and microscopes are male gametes.
Malavika Vibin, what is next? Yes. Malavika, next point.
The female gametes are retained.
Continue.
The female gametes are retained.
You are covering your mouth also. How will I make out? Yes.
The female gametes are retained on the parent.
Okay, Devika.
Ma'am, the female gamete then transforms into young embryo.
Devika.
The female gametophyte then transforms into young embryo.
Okay, Malavika Prabil.
Yes, ma'am. This event is a precursor.
We covered all the points. Yes, Malvika, continue.
One more point. This
okay, one more point. No, that's what he said. Okay.
This step is considered an important step in evolution, for the evolution.
The different groups did we discuss? Meryl, tell me what are the four groups coming under pteridophytes. Will you be able to complete it? I know it's very confusing. No need of examples, only those names.
Psilocida, Lycosida, Cynocida, and Pteridocida.
Now, without referring anywhere, face me and say all the four. Again, you are looking into the book. Once you read, no problem. Then you try to say.
Phylocida, Lycosida, Cerocida, and Pteridocida.
Finished. Okay, children, we'll wind up. See you next class. And this chapter, I think within one more period, I can complete the chapter. So as I had told you earlier, start preparing. Anytime I can ask you for a test paper. Yes. So thank you, children. See you next period.